Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Yes, Lord, we bless you. We worship you. We give you all the glory and adoration. Blessed be thy holy name in the name of Jesus Christ. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. Mazoko Tosakaba. Rabbi Goshikana Masikorobo. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. God bless you. God bless you for being with us tonight. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God. What an awesome God. Oh, yes, Lord, we worship you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Please share this on your wall as you connect. I'm just going to give us 2 minutes to be ready. Then we'll go straight into the Word of God. Tonight is going to be a great night. It's a wonderful night. It's an awesome night. I just want you to be excited as I am, because God is doing some great things in this season. Amen. Mazuku to Sakaba. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Oh, yes, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Can you just invite your friends, family members, to just join us tonight? We are in an interesting topic tonight. We are talking about milk and honey. Amen. I'm just going to write the topic so we can be able to be ready. Amen. While we are waiting, I just want to thank those of you that have connected successfully. Amen. Labo Gushakaraba. Rakata Sikotobo. Lebraga Shikanama Sikanaba. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for who you are, who you represent, and who you will always be. In the name of Jesus Christ. What a mighty God. Oh, yes, Lord, we bless you. We thank you. We give you all the glory and adoration. We worship you. Tonight is another night. We are having our daily update in the spirit. So we are going to pray. Also, it's our daily spiritual update. I want you to make this a common thing to you, because we gather here every night, Monday to Friday, 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Like I said, my name again is Bishop Gabe Ezobele. Hallelujah. We thank you for being with us. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you, Sister Stacy. Greet your husband for me. Amen. Labrogo Shakataba. Let us pray. The Bible says the entrance of the word bringeth light and understanding to the simple. Father, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Let the word that we are speaking and the one that we are going to hear tonight not be an enticing word of a man, but let it be the word of God that will bring glory to thy holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. What a mighty God we serve. He's a mighty God. What a mighty God we serve. Heaven and earth adore him. Angels bow before him. What a mighty God we serve. He's a mighty God. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Heaven and earth adore him. Angels bow before him. What a mighty God we serve. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, give us utterance tonight. God bless you, Pastor IJ. Lord, give us utterance. Give us utterance to be able to speak your word. Without you allowing us to speak, we can't. Lord, may we not speak out of our knowledge. Every knowledge of man, let it be blotted away. But let your will, O Lord Father, be made manifest. In the name of Jesus Christ. We are talking about milk and honey today. And somebody will be asking. I want you also, if you have a question in the course of this, because we want to become, interactive in most of our sections. You can type a question and then I will be answering. God bless you, Sister Marilyn. Amen. I'll be answering your questions as we start every day. I will also do answers, questions, and then also maybe on Wednesday we are going to start to. Also, you can use our Zoom to connect with us. The Zoom meeting number is on the flyer. If you look on my page, you'll find it so that we can be able to figure it out. So if you want to physically come out and we interact with you, you connect with Zoom. We are still going to be on Facebook Live, so whichever one that works for you. But Wednesday, we are going to be ready with that Zoom. Amen. So that we can do Bible studies with it on Thursday. Amen. Labogo Sakaraba, Rabigo Shikanaba. In the name of Jesus. So somebody's asking, why milk and honey? People are suffering. People are dying. And we're talking about blessings. After much suffering in life is much gathering. Every time there is a lot of suffering, God brings gathering. God bless you, Prophet Annie. In the name of Jesus Christ, let's go to the word of God in the book of Exodus chapter 3. And we are reading from verse 7. Oh yes, Lord. We thank you, Holy Spirit. We just read down Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. And the suffering was taught about. So you remember when the children of God left on Passover, we just did Passover on Thursday night. When they moved out of Passover and traveled, hallelujah, God bless you. The Bible said that they crossed the Red Sea and they were in the wilderness and began to move on their journey. But this is what God told them here in Exodus. They were still on that journey. In verse 7 of Exodus chapter 3, the Bible said, the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmaster. For I know their sorrows, so I have come down to deliver them out of the land of Egypt and to bring them up from the land to a good and large land. There's a good land and there's a large land also. The Bible says that to the land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites and the Jebusites. These are the people that were occupying the land at that time. So God told Moses, I'm going to take you to a land. Many of us are living in America, in Europe, in Africa, wherever you are, in Australia, in the Asian continent, Middle East. But God is going to bless you in that land. There is three kinds of land in our life. There's a land of your nativity or the land of your birth. But it's mostly called native. That's why you hear, when you talk about the people, the native people, you know, Native Americans, they are the people that own the land. That's where you are born. So the land of your nativity can be also the land of your possession. It can also be the land of your inheritance. But that land evolves over time, and it can be a different land. You might be born in Georgia, for instance, where we are, and your land of possession will be Washington, D.C. That's where you possess after you graduate from college or after you started working. Maybe you didn't go to college or something, but you end up in D.C. area or Maryland, and you started your life there. It becomes the land of your possession. But after a while, the land becomes an inheritance where God will open up the land for you. Inheritance is something that you don't labor for. It's given to you. If you are a son or a daughter, and you are born into a family of great possession, you don't have to earn an inheritance. Sometimes people can be wicked and say, my son has to earn it. But normally, inheritance are given to you. Sister Doris, God bless you. Mazika Taraba, Rakata Shokorobo. So inheritance are given. It is something that is given to you. So a land of possession is a land you work for. You possess it by what you do, or you possess it by war, you possess it one way or the other. But when it becomes inheritance, it's not what you labor for. So one, a particular land can be three of them for you. But sometimes it can be in different locations, and it can be whatever. But what am I saying is that God is going to take us to that land. There's a place called there. Every time you say, I'm going to get there. That place called there. God is taking us there because we have gone through much suffering. He said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmaster. For I know their sorrow. So God knows what is happening now. It's not something that he did not know. He knew it from the beginning. He knew it even right now. And he's going to continue to know what we do. But he's telling you that in the mix of this, I'm taking you somewhere. I'm going to take you to a place that is large, a place that is great. I'm telling us that in this process that we are going through, it's a very painful one. We are coming out on the other side better than we got in. That is a guarantee. That's an assurance that when we get out on the other side, hallelujah, prophet, God bless you, we are going to be much better than we got in, because God is going to begin to quadruple everything that will happen for you, that will happen for your family. It's not just going to be in the same way that you started. Many of you will start to see your revenues increase. You start to see your positions begin to increase, because God said, inheritance is something you did not labor for. You might have done something in the past, but when it is your time, it will be given to you. God bless you, Sister Stella. Inheritance, it just comes. So if you are a son of a man, a capable man, maybe tomorrow I'm going to talk about a good man and a capable man, but I will see what God wants us to talk about. Once you are a son or a daughter of a capable man, then inheritance is inevitable. God is a good man, and God is also a capable man. Somebody can be a good man and not be a capable man. It is better to be both. Some capable men are not good men. They are terrible men. They are wicked men. But they are capable. So if your father is a capable man, you are guaranteed that you have an inheritance. You have some protection. You have some things at the end of time. But God is telling us, I'm going to give you something. You have come out. You are not just coming out empty, but you are coming out with something. Because after much suffering is much gathering. After much suffering is much gathering. Mazo kuturubo. Rakata sikadaba sikadababa. Rakato shukurubo sukurubo. In the name of Jesus Christ. I want us to also read the book of Leviticus chapter 20. And we are going to read from verse 23. Leviticus 20, 23. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Mikata sakataba. God bless you. Leviticus chapter 20. We are reading from verse 23. We just read about two verses there or three. And we will see. Because this land I'm talking about is coming your way. It's coming your way. You will receive it. Look at verse 23 of Leviticus 20. God said, Mazikataraba, Rakataba, and you shall not walk in the statutes of the nations which I am casting out before you. There are nations that are being cast out as we are speaking. There are countries that are being cast out as we are speaking. There's a lot of suffering and punishment going on there. But God said you should not walk in their statutes. But look at what God said. You should not walk in the statutes of the country that I'm starting. Casting out before you, for they committed all these things, and therefore I abhor them. 24. I want you to see 24 very well. We are reading Leviticus chapter 20, verse 24. But I have said to you, you shall what? Inherit their land, and I will give it to you to possess. A land flowing with what? Milk and honey. I am the Lord your God who has separated you from the people. Hallelujah. God said, I will give you their land. I mean, I'm telling you, just you have to reposition yourself in this season. A lot of things have changed and will never be the same again because of what is going on. But your position is what will guarantee what you will receive in this season. The way you position yourself to be able to get it is what will guarantee the getting. Hallelujah. The getting is just, you have to position yourself very well. You have to really, really position yourself. God say, I will give you what? Inheritance. We're talking about land of your inheritance, land of your possession, and the land of your nativity, where you were born. But God say it has to be a large one. So expect a big miracle, a big bang. I was listening to all the commentators in the news this afternoon. They were talking about the president is preparing to launch a big bang of economic comeback and all that. And some people will say whether it's going to work or not. But what I'm telling you, God is preparing you with a big bang. The coronavirus was a surprise to everybody. We didn't expect the gravity and the magnitude of the suffering. So is God also going to bless. The blessings that will precede this is going to be much great that many people would never expect it. Some people that normally if the year ran the way it was running before, by the end of this year, they will survive it, but they are just going to be in the low, low. God is bringing you back to the upfront. A lot of things are changing. There's a shift in the spirit. There's a paradigm shift. A lot of things are beginning to turn around for your favor. Many times, when God begins to do some things, it's a painful experience to a lot of people. But the people that will make it out will give thanks to God. So I want you to stay the course. Go through this pain. It is painful. It is not something I'm telling you that I am going through it also. We all live in this world. But we are not of this world. Our helper is on the way. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. It's a very painful experience. I know people that have been sick and survived the sickness. I know people that have also died in this season. Hallelujah. So I want you to stay the course and weather the storm. If you can make it out of it by the grace of God, not by your power, not by your might, you will see that after much suffering shall be much gathering. You will begin to enter into the place of milk and honey, a place of great possession, a place that you will look onto your right and onto your left. The things that you have imagined, the things that you have wanted to do before, God is going to begin to do it for you by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus Christ. Many of you wanted to start business. The resources is coming. I don't know how it's going to come, but it's coming. It's coming because the Lord shall open doors for you, doors that you never knew that were there before. They are going to begin to come down in the name of Jesus Christ. There are doors that many of us have never seen. But because everything has gone digital, so you start to see other opportunities that you didn't know existed for you before. Those opportunities have been there. But because we were not wired to think that way, we like to meet and greet, touch everybody. But that time is almost going away. God is shifting us the way we think. God is shifting the way we act, the way we relate with people, the way we talk, the way we talk to God. And so now there is no excuse because meeting people and coming to the presence of God, which is one of the greatest things that God has given to man. But at the time, it became a drag. People come back from work, they're so tired, so I can't go to church. But now, what excuse do you have? You can sit in the comfort of your home and begin to connect to the presence of God and begin to hear the word of God and begin to pray. Many of you, some of you, since this season of coronavirus, your house has become an altar. The prayers that have been made in that house, the angels of God are always singing and praising God in your room, in your living room. Now you don't have nightmares anymore. You go to bed, you have revelations. And many times these are things you have desired. You have desired so long. How can I get close to God? How can I experience the power of God? And almost it was impossible because there was so much things going on. But God decided to reset the wall and have kept you and begin to show himself to you. A lot of revelation are happening. I'm seeing people that have never prophesied before. Prophesying now. I'm telling you, God is speaking to them. A lot of people, their eyes are opening. Their eyes of understanding. Now, things that didn't make sense before begin to make sense. I'm telling you that God's hand is in everything. His hand is in the throttle. His hands are in the gear of what is happening. The Bible says the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. The earth is of the Lord and the fullness thereof. The Bible says God has formed the earth upon the waters. Everything that happens in this earth, even in the world, he knows about it. So hold your peace and weather the storm and go through the process. and you will see yourself in the land that produces milk and honey. The milk and honey is coming. And I know that when that time gets, some people will say, but I didn't get any milk. It's a metaphor. When God talked about milk and honey, it's a metaphor. But the blessings of God that you will get in this season, don't waste it. That's the one thing. Hallelujah. Don't waste it. Because a lot of people, after this process is over, people forget so easily. Many people will start to go into wastage of things, and the resources that you are getting is not to give to Baal. Hallelujah. The Bible says that God asks them to go and borrow from their masters. Hallelujah. Before they leave. And they went and borrowed. And when they borrowed, many of them went and used the same thing that they borrowed from their masters and used it to worship Baal. Hallelujah. They went and used it to worship Baal. God was very, 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 very angry with them. And we are going to talk about that also in the book of Exodus chapter 3. I want us to go down there. Mazuko Toraba, Rakata Shakaba. Exodus chapter 3, when God told them to go and receive. Many of you now, you are getting what is called advance payment from the government. It's not a free money. I'm going to talk about that a little bit. It's a clause on it, but it's also helpful. Many of you that are going to get, if you're a taxpayer, you're getting $1,200. If you're not in America, that does not concern you. That money is a loan. Probably next year, they're going to take it out of your tax return. It's also part of the clause that was written in the wordings of the law when it passed in the Congress, unless if they decide to forfeit it, but it's a loan. So most of these things that happen in the Bible, it has also happened in our time. Let's read Exodus chapter 3 that we were in. Go to verse 22. Masi kataraba rakata shokotobo. The Bible says, every woman shall ask her neighbor, namely of her own dwell near the house, article of silver and article of gold and clothing, and shall put them on their sons and their daughters, and you shall plunder the Egyptians. God say, go and ask your neighbors of gold and silver. The neighbors are the government, the people that were taken from them for 400 years. God say, go back and ask them. And the Bible call it borrowings. They didn't borrow. They say, I need that gold. They gave it to them. By the time the Jews left Egypt, they left with all the resources of the land. And the Egyptians never recovered of it. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. They never recovered. They became poor. So God is going to turn around and use 400 years of suffering. He blessed them in one day. All of them came out wealthy. But at the end, they wasted it because they went and used it to worship Baal. The devil confused them and they began to serve Baal. Don't use God's resources in a wasteful way. Our God is a frugal God. He's a great God. He's a rich God. He's a wealthy God. But also our God is frugal. God don't waste. God hates waste. In any form or way, God hates waste. You are coming out of this process successfully than you entered into it in the name of Jesus Christ. I want us to go to Joshua chapter 1. Look at verse 3, talking about possessing land. So begin to look at what you have in your environment and look at what is possible in what God will do in your life. Many of us have some great skills, but we have been working. It's not a time to do 9-to-5. Use this process to learn a skill. Learn something. Go online. Google about something that you have passion for. Find out the way to do it. By the time we get out of this, you are starting to do it. Even if you take a job of 9-to-5, let that job become a cushion for you where you use to propel what God has put in your life. Because our God have created us to be an engine of businesses, small businesses, big businesses. You are coming out from this process not to go and clock in anywhere again. You are coming out, you might have a part-time job, but there's a business that God is about to give you, but you have to be ready to do it. Amen. Joshua chapter 1, look at verse 3. God starts to speak to Joshua after they have crossed the land. The Bible says to Joshua, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, I have given to you as I said to Moses, from the wilderness of Lebanon as far as the great river of Euphrates. All the land of the Hittites and the great sea towards the going down of the sun shall be your territory. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. So God is talking about land. The first gift to man was land. When God created Adam and Eve, God gave them a piece of land called the Garden of Eden. I'm talking about milk and honey. A land that floweth with milk and honey. God says it's a large land. It's a big land. It's a great land. That land is coming, but it does not come without suffering. It does not come without suffering. There's much suffering before you get to that place. So we are going through it now. It is painful. Blood is going to be involved. Businesses are closing right, left, and center. There is no resources. People's bills are piling up. A lot of people, their lives are being turned off. I just saw in the news today the tornado that passed through Georgia last night. People died. People died in this state, not just from coronavirus. Other things are happening, but because the coronavirus is so enormous and it's like an invisible enemy, it's just sucking out all the energy. There's a lot of things going on behind the scene. More than 9 people have died in the tornado that just hit this state last night and is still going up north. But in all these things, I don't want you to lose focus. I want you to depend on God and begin to put your eyes on Him, because we are getting to the finish line. He said, I will take you to a large place. I will take you to a large land, a land that floweth with milk and honey. That place is where we go. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Rabogo sakataba, rikaraba. So he's telling Joshua, anywhere the sole of your foot, we are walking around. God said, wherever your foot is treading, wherever you step your foot, like many of you that live in London, those of you living in Europe, in Africa, or in America, anywhere in North America, in South America, and you are listening to me in Asia, are you in the Middle East, or in Australia, New Zealand, wherever you are on earth, begin to possess the land, because that's the first thing. Before you are land, you can take a land physically, you have to take it in the spirit. I'm going to give you an example on how God did that deliverance to Abraham. But he said, wherever the sole of your foot, Joshua chapter 1 verse 3, everywhere the sole of your foot shall tread, hallelujah, shall tread upon, hallelujah, I have given to you, it's your inheritance, but you have to tread there. The condition is to put your foot on it. I want us to go to something in Genesis. Genesis chapter 13. This is when God began to come back and try to recover man. God called a man called Abraham. And by this time, his name was still Abraham. And God began to speak to him. Genesis chapter 13. So when Abraham was called by God in Genesis 12, he left. He began to follow God. Things happened. But he went to Egypt, he came back, he was very blessed. Now things are beginning to happen very well. The business is growing. His nephew that was with him has his own servants, and Abraham had his own servants. But they began to have a strife in the camp. The land was not able to take them again because their business have expanded so much. So Abraham said, we are going to break up so that we don't continue to fight for land. But look at what happened. After they divided the land, Abraham called Lot, said, look, the land is big, so I'm going to divide the land. So you look at whichever one you want to take. How can Lot take a land first before Abraham? Abraham was the one that was called by God. Abraham was the one that has the vision. But sometimes, you know, you bring people into a vision, they want to take over the vision, which is not the right thing, but they always pay for it. Look at what happened. Lot looked at the southern part of the land. He looked at the vegetation lands, the land that had grains and there was water in it. The land that moved towards Sodom and Gomorrah. The Bible says he chose that land. He chose that land. Mazika tarababa, rakata sikotobo. I want you to see Genesis 13 when Abraham called Lot in verse 10, and they talked about what is going on. Abraham said, okay, I'm going to give you an opportunity to go your way so that we don't have to fight. In verse 10, he said, and Lot lifted up his eyes and saw the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord. So that place was looking like the Garden of Eden, like the land of Egypt, as you go towards Zoar. So then Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east and separated from, and they separated from each other. Abraham dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the city. You, have you seen what happened there? Lot was brought. It's like when you bring somebody to come and eat with you, they carry the pot and go home. Say, please, hey, you have some little food. He said, please, can we just eat? And they came and said, wow, this food is good. They take the pot. You are the one that called them to eat with you. They are going with the pot. That was what Lot did. Abraham trained Lot. Lot was his brother's son. In fact, Abraham adopted him, took Lot as a son, trained him. Business have grown. Now they strive because the land is so small for them. So they needed to expand. So Abraham divided the land, said, where do you want to go? Just choose. But Lot didn't allow his father, because he was not his biological father. But in terms, Abraham was his father. The Bible says he chose the better part of the land. He chose the city. Look at it again in verse 12. And Abraham dwelt in the land of the Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the city of the plain, and pitched his tent even as far as Sodom. But men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. So he chose the city where evil and sin was. He got it. But was it the good thing for him? But look at what happened in verse 14. And the Bible says, and the Lord said to Abraham, after Lot had separated from him, God didn't speak in the times of this trouble. Like some of you have been asking, some people will call me and say, what is God saying? I say, look, just hold on and hold your peace. In the time of the trouble, God didn't speak. They were fighting. God didn't speak until Abraham called Lot and they separated the land. God didn't speak until Lot left. The moment Lot left, God called Abraham. He gave him the vision. So God came back and said, Abraham, now, look from where you are. Hallelujah. He said, lift up your eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I will give you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth. And so if any man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. Arise, walk. That's where I want you to see verse 17. Arise, walk in the land through the length and the width of it, for I give it to you. So it was given to him. It's an inheritance, but the condition is begin to possess it with your feet. You don't have to put a beam or somewhere to number the land. He said, just arise and walk through the breadth of the land. In after much suffering, remember this was the same Abraham that in Genesis chapter 12, verse 10, the famine wiped him out. Abraham was virtually broke. He became poor and filed for bankruptcy. He went down to Egypt to pick a job. God blessed him through Pharaoh, brought him back to the land of Canaan, a dry land. But God began to bless him in that land. So Lot have been with him and have seen that every time they go down to the plain of Jordan, there's a lot of water there. Their animals can drink and they have vegetation to grow their crops. So he chose that part of the land. He left his master in the dry land. But what happened? God said, lift up your eyes. And Abraham began to look, and God gave him, including Sodom and Gomorrah, God gave him Africa. God gave him Europe. God gave him America. God gave him Middle East. God gave him the world. That was the vision. The Bible says, God said, lift up your eyes. Look, and there is nothing to see in a dry land. It was a dry land. But God said, look from where you are. So sometimes when God is going to bless you, God is not taking you into the place of the blessing. God will bless you from where you are. He can show you the whole of this country from Georgia or from your small town, wherever you are. God can give you a nation. God can give you Africa from a place that is not even in Africa. But you have to see it. God said, look from where you are. God gave him the four cardinal points. Number four is the north, south, east, and west. God gave him the four cardinal points of the earth. God said, look northward, look southward, look eastward. It was deliverance. God was delivering the poor mentality of Abraham. Say, don't worry about the Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm giving you the world. He can take Sodom, but I'm going to give you the whole world. That's why we have the children of Abraham in Africa. We have them in Europe. We have them in the Middle East. We have them in Asia. We have Christians even in America. God, Abraham saw you today that is listening to me. Abraham saw you from that land. He visibly, because God is telling him now about the children and the dust of the earth and how the children are going to be millions and billions of children all over the world. How I will give them to you. But you have to see them. A land that floweth with milk and honey. Mazokotorobo. Rakata shikataba. Ribaga sikonomo sakataba. Rakito sokorobo shokotobo sekerebababa. In the name of Jesus Christ, Abraham saw you. And today you are a Christian. He saw America. He saw Europe. He saw Asia. He saw Africa. He saw the whole land of Middle East there. But God said, look from there. And he began to see. But God said, walk in the length of the land and in the breadth of the land. You have to walk in that land. You have to begin to walk and possess it. So we have a land of our possession and we have a land of our inheritance. Mazoko torubu sakataba, rikata shikadama, mazikataba. We are going to pray now. Hey, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. But God said something before when they were leaving the land of Egypt. God said, I'm going to remove something from you. And that's what we are going to start today because there is a lot of suffering everywhere. Exodus chapter 23, I want us to read from verse 24 and downward to 25. Exodus 23, so the everyday sickness of the Egyptian, the sickness of the unbelievers, the sickness that is around now, God is going to take it away from us. We don't want to go into our land with that sickness. We don't want to go with this sickness, the pestilence that is moving at day and the one that works at noonday. 1,000 shall fall by our side, 10,000 by our right hand. Look at what the Bible says in Exodus chapter 23. And look at verse 24. Hallelujah. Mazoko turubu rakata baba. Libarga shikorubu bubu rakata sikana mama. Rekata. Let's go back to 23:23. Hallelujah. But indeed, obey. 23 verse 23 says, for my angel will go before you and bring you into the Amorite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Canaanite and the Hivite and the Jebusite, and I will cut them off. God is these places we are calling, they are all lands. I will take you there and I'll begin to give you those places and I will cut them off. Look at 24, Exodus 23:24. You shall not bow down to their gods. Many of you, the Baals, the Babylonians, the God of Mammon will present themselves as the angel of light because of what is happening. Don't bow. Don't bow to any God. Serve the living God. I don't care what they bring and say, this is God. This is good. You have to. If you do this, this will happen. Forget about it. God gave them a charge. He said, you shall not bow to their gods, nor serve them, nor do according to their works, but you shall utterly overthrow them and completely break down their secret pillars. Verse 25, we're going to stop there. It says, so you shall serve the Lord, as we are talking today, make an altar in your house. You shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your waters, and I will take sickness away from you, your mix. I will take sickness away from the mix of you. No one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land, and I will fulfill the number of your days. This is long life. God, three things God promised here. He said, you shall not worship idol, which is kind of a standard procedure. Because you are serving me, I don't want you to have any other God. God is a jealous God. But he went further. He said, I will take away sickness from your mix. The sickness of the Egyptians cannot come near you. The sickness of the unbeliever, the sickness that is out now, God said, I will take it away from you. It will never come near. I will bless your water also. I will bless your business. I will bless your bread, your food, everything that you put in your mouth. I will bless it. That means even if you drink deadly things, it shall not harm you. I will bless your food. I will bless your water. I will take away sickness from you. And number three, he said, no one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. You shall not lose anything. Loss is far away from you. In the name of Jesus Christ, nothing shall be barren or miscarriage in your life. Sometimes people talk about barrenness, you look at businesses only, or look at you're a pregnant woman or something. No, barrenness can be anything. If your land is barren, that land cannot produce. So God is talking about a large land, a land that flow with milk and honey. That means the land will always produce for you. Every land you are standing upon shall become a land that flow with milk and honey. It will always produce good fruit. It will always produce resources. It will always produce peace for you. It will produce health. You will not be in a land that is blessed, but you can't sleep. Every night you are sleeping with a god because people can come to rob you or they want to kill you. That is not a peaceful land. God is saying, I'm going to give you peace. I will take you to a large land, a land that floweth with milk and honey, that will give you all that you need. And also, I will take sickness away from you, because heaven and earth is controlled by the Almighty God. If the devil wants to bring sickness or infirmity, God says that will not happen. I will take it away from you in the name of Jesus Christ. And also, he said, nothing shall be barren in your land. Nothing. Nothing shall cast thy young. But I want you to see the last thing here. He said, I will fulfill the number of your days. That means you shall live to the fullness of time. Long life. I will fulfill the number of your days. I will fulfill the number of your days. You shall live long. I will satisfy you with long life. I want us to begin to thank God right now. Begin to appreciate him, for he is God. Remember what God said. Well, let's do a recap. Say, I'm taking you to a land. I've heard the cry of my people. I am come down to deliver them in Exodus 3:7. And I'm bringing you out from a land of bondage of your taskmaster. But I'm taking you to a place called a land that floweth with milk and honey. Many of us will say, okay, when they got there, they never saw milk rushing in the streets. But the land was blessing them. You didn't plant crops and you are harvesting them. Many of them never built houses and they lived in those houses. This is what we're talking about, inheritance. Inheritance, you don't have to do anything. Maybe you have done something in the past, but there is no immediate thing that would be connected to your inheritance. Because you are a son or a daughter, you are qualified for an inheritance. God is saying, I'm giving you an inheritance. America can be your land of possession and the land of your inheritance until you begin to walk in that land and begin to possess it now. It will not happen. Let's thank God for tonight. Let's begin to appreciate God for what he has said and what he's doing in the name of Jesus. Mazi kataraba, rakata shokotobo, rakata sika namasokorobobo, libraga shakataba satarababa. Father, we bless you. We thank you. We worship you. We give you all the glory and adoration. Have your way, O Lord, that your name will be glorified. Blessed be thy holy name. Mazi kataraba, rakata shokotobo kataba. In the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you for life, we thank you for healing, we thank you for prosperity, we thank you for advancement, we thank you for what you are doing and what you continue to do. Have your way, O Lord, that your name will be glorified. Thank you for health, thank you, O Lord, for that, for protection. Mazi kataraba, rekata sikotobo, yakata shikanama sakaraba. Holy Spirit divine, we give you all the glory and adoration. We worship you for who you are, who you represent, and who you will always be. Have your way, O Lord, that your name will be glorified. Blessed be thy holy name. Mazi ketereba, rakato shokotobo. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Maza kataraba, rekata sikotobo, sakataba, rakata shokotobo, sokorobo. I want us to present ourselves unto God as a living sacrifice. Every time we come to God, we come with humility of heart. We come to receive salvation, which is forgiveness of sin. We come to ask for mercy so that mercy can be abounding in our lives. Ask God to have mercy upon you and your family. Let mercy begin to move in you. The Bible says the time to favor you is now. In the book of Psalm 103, mercy, let the spirit of mercy be activated in you. There's a spirit of mercy. Mercy is what carries the integrity of God. If God found mercy in your sight, you will supersede every judgment, even in the land where you are. A land can be judged, a family can be judged, a person can be judged. But if mercy is found in you, judgment has disappeared. Today, let mercy begin to speak for you. Father, we activate mercy upon this altar. We activate mercy upon your sons and daughters, as many that are hearing the sound of my voice. Let mercy, let the power of mercy, the spirit of mercy begin to come upon them right now. In the name of Jesus, begin to wash us, O Lord, by the precious blood of Jesus that was shed upon the cross of Calvary. We receive mercy. We receive forgiveness of sins. We receive, O Lord, the spirit of forgiveness. We receive the spirit of mercy. Let favor, O Lord, come unto our life. We ask for favor. We ask for grace. Grace will carry you. Hallelujah. When the angel of favor and grace is in your life and you have mercy, there is no limitation. You will be unlimited in everything that you can do and you will do. God is going to take you there. I'm telling you, this month, this next month, going down till the end of the year, we are not giving out an inch. We are standing with God. We are standing with you. We are standing for good. We are praying. What am I saying? There is nothing that we cast thy young. We just tabulated what God said I will do. I want us to go back and look at it. The first thing he said, I will bless your bread. Hallelujah. I will bless your bread and your water. So ask God to bless your bread and your water. What is bread? Bread is your business where you get money. Like in America, they say, if I don't have enough bread in that business, so I'm not going to do it. Bread is resources, money, business, food. Where your food comes from is your bread. What you go out every day to work for is for your bread, to be able to have food and shelter. God say, I'm going to bless your bread and your water. I'm going to bless your bread and your water. What you drink, what you eat, what takes care of you, I will bless it. I will bless it. Lord, ask God to bless your bread and water. A lot of people are, I see there is looting in Africa now. That's one of the things that we are going to pray for Africa tonight. That this quarantine and shutdown should not cause people to go into the street and begin to kill people for nothing. Because their problem is not even the coronavirus. Their problem is now people are locked down in their houses. They can't go to their farms. They can't go to their businesses. Many of them don't have food to eat. Food. So food becomes even more essential than any other thing. Many people will damn anything and go out and even commit murder because of food. So ask God to bless your food, to bless your food, to bless your business, to bless your water, what you drink, what you eat, your house. Let blessings come upon you. He said, I will bless your water and your bread. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we commit our bread, we commit our water, we commit our business, we commit our families, we commit our lives unto you. Bless us all over. Bless the going out and the coming in. Bless everything that we do. Bakataraba, rokoto sakataba, rikata shikanama, sokotobo yekeneba, mazikotorobo, rakata shikanaba. In the name of Jesus Christ, bless the works of our hands. Thank you for it is done. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. The second thing that God said here, and I will take sickness away from the midst of you. Sickness, in whatever it is, sickness. Sickness of the blood, sickness of heart, sickness of the body, sickness of poverty. Anything that is sickness. Poverty is a cause. It's a sickness. Any sickness of bone marrow, sickness of heart, skin sickness, whatever it is. Viral sickness of the lungs, respiratory illness or sicknesses, witches and wizardry attacking you. It's a sickness. Whatever it is, God say, I will take sickness away from you. Whatever kind of sickness. Some people cannot sleep. Some people cannot sleep. That's why you have to, as we are praying every day, if you can pray every day for 21 days, it will become a habit. Since we started praying last year, March 1st, we made 1 year this year. Every day, Monday to Friday, we are praying. March 1st, last year we started. It was like a joke. God said, go and pray. And I said, well, how do you say, just go and pray. I pray again. I came back to God. Say, what? Say, go and pray. So we just started praying. And we are still praying. And we'll continue to pray. It is now a lifestyle. I don't struggle to do it again. Then, if I have an appointment in the evening, I'm going to try to struggle to cancel. But now my mind is made up. We don't put anything between 7 to 8 o'clock, whatever it is. Even though if it's anything, we are going to just shut it down and say, it is time to be with God that 1 hour. So ask God to take away sicknesses, whatever it is, as we pray here every day, you will see that your life becomes easy and better. This is what we provide. It's not common out there to have prayer go on every day. And not just that we pray for this 1 hour. You can call for prayers. You can call, you can write me a message, say, please, Bishop, I need you to pray for me for this ABC. We pray. It is not something we have to go and do some things to get. It is now a lifestyle. We live this way. Ask God to remove sickness, whatever sickness in your life, heart disease, sickness of stroke, high blood pressure, diabetes, sickness of aging. Aging is a sickness sometimes. People, when they start to age, a lot of things will start to happen. But Bible says that your days shall be fulfilled. That means you will be healthy throughout your old age. I will make you strong. So, I will make you strong. Is that your bones will not be weak and tired. You will walk well. The waters in your body will not go into where blood is supposed to be. There shall be no malfunctioning in your life. God said, I will take away sickness so that at the fullness of time, you will just sleep in the Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, without going through multiple years of months of pain or agony, and that person will be dead before they die. That will not happen. God said, I will take sickness away from you. Ask God to remove every sickness. Is it whatever it is? In this season of polling, there's a lot of people going through asthmatic attack. Asthma attack is dangerous. Sometimes because we have medication for it, we have the ventilator that we use or whatever the machine that people use to breathe. and the what's the other one that they pop in. Many of you will know, I'm not asthmatic, but I know some of these things. So we think that we can depend on that thing. God can heal you from asthma. Whatever it is, I've seen somebody walk into the church. One of our daughters came. The first time I prayed for her, I just said, come, let me pray for you. I said, what do you want me to pray for you? She said, I used to have asthma. Every 2-3 days, I have asthma. And she have this little thing that she used, inhaler. That's the word I'm looking for. Somebody could have typed it for me. Inhaler. And I said, okay, I'm going to pray with you. And I'm not God, but God is going to heal you. We prayed that day. That attack left for almost 1 year. She was telling me, 1 year and she has never had an attack. This is somebody that have attack every day or every other day. They have asthma attack. So they walk around carrying inhaler everywhere. God can heal you from that. Even if it's in your gene, it's going to go. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, every respiratory illness, every high blood pressure, diabetes. You can say my father died of high blood pressure, my mother died of it, so it's in our gene. Those are the things that the doctors, they use. They say, okay, who have anybody been sick in this in your family? If we go back 300-400 years, some of this sickness never existed. So how did it just pop out in a family? And they say the devil has sowed that seed, and now the doctors are letting you know that it is generic, it is in your gene, so you have to accept it. No, we are not accepting anything. In the family of Abraham, people die young. His father died young. His brother died in Haran, died young, the father of Lot. And Abraham could have died young also. God said, no, death is going to go away from your family. I'll begin to give you long life. Abraham lived 100 years in the eyes of God, plus the 75 years he was living with his father. So if you add it together, he lived 175 years, a very long life. You can live long. So whatever has been the pattern of your family can be broken now. God said, I will take away sickness. Even untimely death is sickness. Every time somebody is dying in the family, you have to do better. I will take away sickness from your mix. Coronavirus, whatever sickness it is, Lord, we ask for healing now. From the crowns of your head to the sole of your foot, by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus, let healing come upon you now. Let the healing power of God, I release the power of God to heal. The Bible says, I am the God that healed thee. So our God is a healer. Jesus said, by the stripe of Jesus Christ, we are healed. The blood of Jesus Christ is what cleanses us from every unrighteousness and brings healing. Let the healing power of God come upon you. Makata raba, rekata saba. You are the God that healed us. That's what the Bible says. He's a healer. Receive healing now upon your life, upon your ministry, your business, upon your family, your marriage. Your marriage can be sick. Even people can also be emotionally sick. Jesus said, I will heal the brokenhearted. Is your heart broken through a relationship? A man or a woman have broken your heart and you don't know what to do. You don't trust anybody again. You don't want to get into any relationship because your heart has been broken and you have been trying to overcome it, but it is not possible. Today, receive healing. God is giving you a new heart. You shall love again. You shall smile again. You shall be happy again. I don't care what that man or that woman did in your life. Today, let healing. There shall be closure in your life. Because God is healing you. He's a healer. Makaraba, rakoto sukubo. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Labo shakarababa. The next thing God said here, hallelujah. I just want to pray the prayer as it is written down here. The next thing we have here, la karaba. He said, no one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. No one shall suffer miscarriage. That means things will not die in your hand. God bless you. Hallelujah. If you receive it, just say, I receive it. Or you say, amen. Because that's the way, when you say amen, you are in agreement. Or you say, I receive it. Don't just hear the prayer, but type it so that it becomes what you have received. I thank you for those of you that say, I receive it. Amen, amen. It is the way to receive. When you hear what blesses you, you receive them. And as you receive it, you are concurring. The Bible says, if two shall agree, touching anything, it shall be established in heaven and on earth. So the next prayer we are praying is, no one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. That's one of the promises that God gave us as we are coming out of this terrible pandemic and quarantine and shutdowns. Nothing shall cast thy young. Nothing shall be miscarried. You will not lose your business place. You will not lose your shops. A lot of people cannot pay their rents. Hallelujah. A lot of churches will not be able to pay their rents and their mortgages. Businesses, restaurants. A lot of businesses, but God said nothing shall be scattered. You will not lose it because you didn't have money. The money will come by the time this is over. You will be able to pay even with any arrears, all your bills, light bills, water bills, whatever it is. Hallelujah. I'm praying for you and I'm praying for myself. The church bills shall be paid also. The lights, the water, the everything that we use here, the gadgets, the internet, the gas, we will be able to meet up. God, because God said, no one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren. That means barrenness is, that means the thing is not producing again. Miscarriage is you losing something that you always have. We cannot lose our positions. We cannot lose our place in life. We cannot lose our businesses. Even if you have lost a job, let me tell you, a good job, a better job is coming to you by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus. Money cometh. I say, call upon money, it shall come to you. Money have ears and it can also fly away. So I begin to call resources, whatever it is that will sustain you to go through this. Is the devil holding your finances? The Bible says nothing shall be barren in your land. Nothing shall be barren. So this land of Georgia, the land of Lebanon, the land of Atlanta, will begin to produce for me. It will produce for you your land, whatever land you are standing upon. Let the resources in that land, the hidden resources, the blessings of the land begin to come to you, because this land shall produce. The Bible says it shall become to you a land that flow with milk and honey. So barrenness is far away from your life. Very, 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 very far from your family, far away from where you come from. Makaraba, Sokotobo, Rakita Sakaba, Likataba, Shokonobo. Let barrenness die now. Everything that has not produced, is it? Are you married and you have not had a child this hour? I command the power that gives children. The Bible says children are gifts from God. Let the gift of childbearing come upon you. Are you a woman? You are looking for the fruit of the womb today. As I'm speaking to you, put your hand upon your stomach. Let your hand touch your belly button. In the name of Jesus Christ, let life begin to move into you. Whatever is wrong with your system, your reproductive system, today I begin to correct it by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus. Healing upon your land. Upon the land where you are, you can stand for your family member, for your friend, for somebody you know, for a church member. I say, receive the fruit of the womb now. Receive it today by the authority. Let the joy of birth happen in your family. Children will begin to cry around you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for we know that you have done it, because nothing shall be barren in your land. Not even your sons, they will have their own children. Your grandchildren will have children. Your great-grandchildren will have children. They shall be, your family tree will not die. People will continue to reproduce in your family, both financially, materially, spiritually, and otherwise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And the last prayer we have here before we pray for what is going on now is, I will fulfill the number of your days. That's what the Bible says. I will fulfill the number of your days. If God has proposed that you shall live 100 days, nothing will cut you short. Nothing, not even coronavirus or the pestilence that work at noonday, or what is going on, or high blood pressure or stroke. People are dying mostly not of the disease of coronavirus, but when their lungs are shut up, many of them have pneumonias and die. People have heart attacks. That is one of the things, the trait of this virus. I don't care what it is. God said, I will fulfill the number of your days. I will fulfill it. So my side of the contract is guaranteed. I will fulfill the number of your days. But I want you to do also something to help yourself. Don't eat all this processed food, junk food, and anything that will distort your body system. God is going to help you. He will do as much as he can. But I want you to use this time of quarantine, begin to eat healthy. Eat vegetables, a lot of minerals, a lot of fruits. Fruit and vegetables, they are very, very essential. And stay away from red meat and all that. You eat a little bit of that. That doesn't mean that I'm saying you should be a vegetarian. I am not. But I want you to be moderate in what you do. Drink a lot of water. Stop drinking soda and all these things, coffee with sugar. All these things, they have side effects. When you put a lot of toxins in the body most times will be tired and they couldn't function again. They shut down. Our body is a very big organ. So I want you to help yourself while God is helping you. But we are going to pray. If your body have already been compromised, let God begin to recover your body now. In the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, I will fulfill the number of your days. Long life is part of your life. You say, with long life, I shall satisfy you. Long life is part of our inheritance. It's part of our inheritance. I will fulfill the number of your days. Lord, I will live as long as you have proposed for me. The devil cannot cut me short. My lifestyle will not cut me short. Sickness will not cut me short. Nothing shall cut me short in your presence, because I am in your presence. The Bible says, in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. I stand today. Our days shall be fulfilled. Sister Laraba, God bless you. God says, I will fulfill the number of your days. Let our days be fulfilled now. God is going to restore your health. And if your body has been compromised, whatever has been compromised, God is a creator. He can create a new lungs, a new liver, a new kidney, a new whatever it is, respiratory illness, or your tracts or your organs, everything. Is it your large or small intestine, your blood vessels, every part of your body can be created again. By the authority, you cannot die young. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And I talked about two places we are going to pray now. We are going to pray about what is going on here in America. We still have people dying everywhere. We are going to pray that death should pass away and pass by. Because God said this too shall pass away. The surge has gone by. I'm telling you what we are seeing now is the debris of what the devil has done and what this virus brought. God, at least God have made a statement. We have understood where God is standing. We are praying for the paramedics, the doctors, the people in the front line, everyone that is working at this time. Is it in the grocery stores, people that work in gas stations that touch the pumps and all that touch money? And everywhere, Lord, we ask for protection for them. Everyone that have life, that is held, that is in this, in the eye of this virus, that is in the middle of it, that is in the front line, the drivers, the janitorial workers, EMT drivers, the people that pick up trash in hospitals, in different places, the CNAs, the medical doctors, the nurses, the paramedics of any kind, phlebotomy, people in the lab that is touching this virus, playing with it, trying to discover a vaccine, none shall die. Lord, we ask for total protection from America to the whole world. We blanket the world with the blood of Jesus, even to Africa. Lord, we ask for the pain of this thing, those that are struggling for their life now, that are on machines, on ventilators in different hospitals, from New York down to Atlanta, where we are here, even up to California, to Florida, and to North Dakota. We cover the whole America with the blood. We cover all of our other places, other part of the world, Africa, Mazika Taraba. Let the healing power of God begin to move in these places, in Europe, in Africa, in Asia, in Australia, in New Zealand, Lord, all over the world, South America, Brazil. We start to cover everywhere the blood of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, let us all over, we hold these nations and we lift up our hands in the spirit, and we ask that as our hands are lifted up in one accord, let the healing power of God begin to blanket these nations. And all of a sudden we wake up and this news is gone. Because I see a great day. I see a new day. I see something new, something tangible happening. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, for we know that you have done it. We give you all the glory and adoration. Blessed be the holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We are going to pray for people that cannot buy food. I was watching some videos that are coming out from Africa in some remote areas. People are going out on the street looting because the government says stay home. And many of these people, they do service business. They sell one thing, they eat. They sell two things, they eat one. They sell three, they eat two. So they are surviving daily. Now you say you shut them off and you couldn't provide food for them. People are running the street. People are committing crime. I don't want anarchy to take over the world. You know, and the things that were said about Africa will never come to pass. Everyone that is proposing in their heart, in their mind, for dead people to litter the streets of Africa, we cancel the spirit of death in Africa. We cancel the spirit of cacophony and violence in any form or way, that people should not take laws into their hand and begin to be on the street and disrupting society. And also let the government of these nations in Africa, let them begin to look at their citizens and begin to see value in them. Because you can't tell people to stay at home when they don't have food. When you have pushed people to the wall to this level, they will come back and fight back. We cover the whole nations of Africa from Cairo to Cape Town. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. From Nigeria up to Kenya. In the name of Jesus, we blanket Africa with the blood. We protect lives. A lot of young people are in that nation. Africa is where they have the youngest population in the whole world. 70% of African population is less than 35 years. That is a lot of people. That's a lot of power. About 700 to 800 million people. Africa is about 1.6 billion people. It's a very big populated continent with about 56 countries. We cover every part of that continent with the blood of Jesus. The violence that is proposed and has been set in the spirit, the things that the devil has planned against Africa will never come to pass. By the authority and the power in the, I want you to help me in this prayer. We will not hear any bad news because many of us were born in Africa. I can't just say I'm a black person, not just being born in Nigeria, but I'm also an African. The blood of Africa running me. So if something is happening there, it touches my life somehow. I want us to pray and say, Father, by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus, total protection, even if they are not our family members or people we know, but we ask for lives to be preserved. Lives of young men and women. People should not die out of the foolishness of the government. By the authority and the power in the name of Jesus, let food be provided for them. Above all, Lord, we ask for peace to reign. That in this middle of this, that people will not start to break out. There will be wars in different places. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for we know that you have done it. We give you all the glory and adoration. We exalt, we magnify you. We thank you for life. We thank you for healing. We thank you for prosperity. We thank God for the milk and the honey. As we are going through this process, we will come out on the other side, knowing fully well that God have visited our homes, our families, our lives, our ministries, ourselves. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. I'm going to give you an opportunity if you are here for the first time, you are not giving your life to Christ, or you are going to watch this in the future. I want you to just say after me, Lord Jesus, come into my life. I believe with my heart that you died for my sins, and I confess that you are my Savior. Jesus Christ, come into my life. Jesus Christ, come into my life. Jesus Christ, come into my life. If you have done that, you are born again. Just find a Bible-believing church and fuse yourself. And if you are in Georgia, we are not shy to tell you to connect with us. As you are watching us today, you can connect with this ministry. We need workers to work with us online on different things that we are doing. And I'm going to plead with you as you are watching me. Share these videos on your wall. If it's not for you, it can be for somebody or somebody that you don't even know. You might be blessing them. And also, look for me on YouTube. We are trying to move a campaign to get up to 1,000 subscribers. Go to my YouTube. Just type on YouTube.com. You type my name, Bishop Gabe. Bishop Gabe, G-A-B-E. You will see my picture there. And just click on the subscribe button. That's all you do. And send it to your friends to subscribe. We want to hit 1,000 subscribers in a very short time so that we can be able to do more. So that some of the things I'm doing here, I can be doing Facebook Live and be doing YouTube Live also at the same time. So you can have our videos in different places. But I thank you for being with us and thank you for coming together and staying with us. And I continue to ask for God to give you what you are looking for. Whatever you are looking for, let it begin to look for you now. I speak by the authority and the power in the name of Jesus Christ. God bless you. We love you. And I'm going to see you tomorrow. Every time it's 7 p.m. Eastern time, it is a great time to come for daily prayers with Bishop Gabe. God bless you. Amen.